Shields up, Ironbreakers. Rurikon here coming at you with another video, and today we're going to be smashing that games are too expensive to produce argument, which is something that I have mentioned in passing in quite a few videos in the past, but today we're going to be focusing exclusively on that as much as I possibly can. I know that my voice still sounds pretty bad because I'm still kind of sick, and I'm sorry about that, but we just have to deal with it. Anyway, moving onwards. Before we start this video, I would like to make sure that I mention that I think every gamer out there appreciates visual fidelity. I think we all like beautiful graphics. I think we all like fantastic animations. Me, personally, I love good animation, you know? I'm just really a huge fan of that. And I'm not saying that these are not things that are important. However, what I do want to bring up is I think that these are things that are important so much as you can deliver them without having to envelop yourself into shady business tactics and then having to force microtransactions down people's throats to the point where they're actually going to compromise something that we value even more than the visuals, which is the gameplay of your video game. Because we all love visuals, we all love good sound, we all love high fidelity stuff between the sound and the visuals, and just like the best looking games, the best sounding games, the best animation games. We all love that. But there is one thing that we value above all of those things, and that thing is gameplay. Gameplay is the most important aspect of your game. And why is this important? Because we've seen a lot of studios say, oh, it's so expensive to develop these games, so now we have to do these microtransaction things, and we have to put in these loot boxes and all of these other things. And what you need to keep in mind is that these other things that you're talking about between the loot boxes and the microtransaction garbage, all of those things impact gameplay. Doesn't matter how much you want to say they don't impact gameplay, they will always impact gameplay, because as soon as you put a loot box into a video game, there is quite simply a temptation to adjust certain values in the game, particularly if it's a loot-driven game, to adjust the values in a game to make that loot box matter for something. One of the best examples of this is Diablo 3, which was pretty much a piece of garbage when it came to loot, until they came up with what they called Loot 2.0 and got rid of the real money auction house, which was a big problem as far as that game is concerned. And it is also why, in my opinion, the console is still the best version ever to come out of that game, because by the time the console version came out, there was no real money auction house. As a matter of fact, I don't think the console version has an auction house, period. I'm not even sure how the PC version is handling the auction house at this point, because I haven't played on the PC for so long. But I think there's still like an in-game currency auction house, maybe. Is there? There isn't? I don't know. Either way, what matters most is that this was a game, and this is not even because of visual fidelity. This, I mean, although you do have to admit that Diablo 3 looks pretty damn good, at least in my opinion. But I don't think it was because of visual fidelity. It was just Blizzard trying to push this microtransaction as far as they possibly could take it, which later culminated into the loot boxes of Overwatch, but let's not even go down that path right now. The point to be made here is the fact that they put in those microtransactions, not even microtransactions, a real money auction house, because it was controlled by players. The fact that they put that in affected in a very negative way the chance for loot to drop, how good the loot would be, which basically funneled players into the auction house. And it was the main reason why I stopped playing Diablo 3, was that auction house. So here you can see where gameplay was severely compromised by the microtransaction, so to speak, system that was applied into a game. Now, another interesting thing is I've heard this excuse mostly throughout, I guess. I think we've been hearing this excuse pretty much for like 5 years now or something, where developers and publishers are constantly saying games are so expensive to develop, that's why we have to come up with alternate revenue streams, and all this other, this argument that has been going on for quite some time, right? And it never ceases to amaze me that I've played a lot of games this year in 2017, As a matter of fact, this has been one of the best gears, one of the best years in gaming for the last decade, easily, at least in my personal opinion, because we've seen a lot of really amazing titles. I'm not going to get into that right now. I'm going to have a separate video talking about all the best games and all that stuff. But ultimately, what I wanted to say is we're currently in November, and I've played a ton of games at this point that were released this year. But the interesting thing that I find is that for all this argument that games are really expensive because of visuals and audio and all this other stuff, out of the best games that I have played this year, and I do mean like the best of my personal choice of what I think are the best games to come out this year, only one of those games has really pushed visual fidelity beyond the norm. Only one of those games has really pushed, you know, how good it looks, how well it animates, how good it sounds, how good it feels, you know? Only one of those games really pushed the visual envelope beyond what you would expect. And again, bear in mind, this is very much my personal opinion. You might have different games that you feel have pushed the thing beyond anything that is acceptable. But to me, the best looking game that I really enjoyed playing this year so far, in terms of just raw visuals, I'm not talking about just sheer gameplay or anything like that. I'm not saying that this is my game of the year. I'm saying that this is a game that I really enjoyed and that has really pushed the visual look and animation and all that stuff. That game's Horizon Zero Dawn. And the most interesting thing about the fact that that game is Horizon Zero Dawn is that Horizon Zero Dawn doesn't have any of these things that developers are constantly saying they have to put into the games in order to make them look this good. Because developers are saying, oh, we have to put in microtransactions. Oh, we have to do this thing. Oh, we have to do this other thing to monetize and additional revenue streams and all these other things. And you look at Horizon Zero Dawn, which is, in my opinion, the best looking game that came out this year that I really enjoyed playing, and it doesn't have any microtransactions. It doesn't have any loot boxes. It recently received a DLC, and that's pretty much it. It apparently is going to be the last piece of DLC that that game is going to get, because they're going to make that game into, at least I think it's supposed to be, a trilogy, which only goes to show that, like, this game that came out, it's feature complete, it's a full game, it is not piecemeal DLC like a lot of people like to do in the gaming industry nowadays. It is not split up, it is not nothing like that. It is a full experience, beginning to end, full story, full game, you get everything. And it looks fucking fantastic, and it doesn't use any microtransaction nonsense, any loot box nonsense, none of that. And it sold so well, and it was received so well, that they're going to be able to do a trilogy out of it. It just goes to reinforce the idea that, like, for instance, people have been talking about The Witcher 3, which, again, is a full, complete experience, beginning to end. There's two pieces of DLC that it received, which people have talked a lot about in a positive fashion as well. And, again, it is a complete experience, no DLC. As a matter of fact, with The Witcher 3, you have the added bonus, no DLC and no DRM if you're playing on the PC. And it's just like, again, feature complete, looks amazing, animates amazing, great game. Didn't use any of this microtransaction loot box nonsense. Then you look at some of the other titles that are using this loot box and microtransaction stuff, like you look at Destiny 2, you look at now the recently released Need for Speed Payback, you look at the upcoming Battlefront 2, you look at Call of Duty World War 2, which are just pushing the microtransaction envelope as well as the loot box system as far as they can possibly take it to maximize profits, and still aren't really necessarily pushing the boundary of what a really amazing visual experience is. I mean, let's look at Destiny 2, for instance. It doesn't even look that different from Destiny 1. Bear in mind, I played Destiny 2. I love the time that I've spent with Destiny 2, and ultimately, I got burnt out on Destiny 2, specifically because of the loot box mechanics, which is interesting if you take into consideration that these loot boxes and microtransactions are there to keep players invested and playing the video game and all this other stuff. And ultimately, what they ended up doing is the exact opposite. I burnt out on Destiny 2 because the loot box system was just so fucking random that I couldn't get the things I needed to level up my character. And there's no way that I'm going to be supporting the microtransaction system like that. So it was just like, whatever, you know? Now you also have Need for Speed Payback, in which, here's the thing. I like the core game that Need for Speed Payback is. I understand it is not a game for everyone, but I like a cool arcade racer where I can do crazy shit, blow up cars, do all kinds of ridiculous nonsense that have no place in like a racing game that is more simulation oriented. But I like that kind of stuff, you know, and there's entertainment value in that. It's almost like Need for Speed Fast and the Furious. So I like the core gameplay, but then they put the loot box system in there. And essentially what the loot boxes in Need for Speed made me do is I can never really take the meta game of Need for Speed Payback seriously. What do I mean by this? I'm never going to fully upgrade a car to its maximum value because it's virtually impossible to do so because it's so fucking random. I'm not even kidding. If you guys go and watch my Need for Speed video, you will understand just how random it is to actually be able to get good parts for your car to the point where in order for a player to really min-max his vehicle, he's going to have to borderline on obsession if he wants to really do that. And he's still going to have to put an ungodly amount of hours into Need for Speed Payback, which, in my opinion, shouldn't be what the game should be about at all. As a matter of fact, if anything, the loot boxes are acting as a deterrent to me playing more Need for Speed Payback, because I'm probably going to finish the campaign and I'm not going to want to upgrade my car to the maximum it could possibly achieve because it's too fucking random. There are just way too many variables in the loot box system, you know? So again, another loot box system that is working as a deterrent to me actually enjoying that video game. I'm also curious to test out Battlefront 2. I haven't gotten to play it yet, and I don't check up on every little video that people do analyzing the microtransactions on that game. Although I know that I recently saw a video of a guy who spent like $90, and he was just like decimating everyone because he was just so overpowered with all the stuff he got from the loot cards and stuff. But that is a game that I will have to test out for myself. But ultimately, again, just like it got hit heavy with people seriously criticizing the beta of that game because of its loot system. So if you ask me, this concept of video games being now more expensive than ever to produce, while it might be correct, it seems to me that the better critically acclaimed video games, as well as some of the best looking video games that have come out in the past 2 years, and the ones that have sold the most and all this other stuff, these are actually video games that do not use these shady video game mechanics of including all of these crazy microtransactions and loot box nonsense and all of that stuff. So that argument that, oh, it's so expensive and now we need to do this thing in order for it to pay off is a load of bullshit, or B, just straight up poor management of your team. Because if these other teams like CD Projekt Red and Guerrilla Games are able to produce these games that are pushing the boundaries of the visual fidelity and the sound fidelity and animation wise and all of these other things, if they are able to push these boundaries without implementing any of these garbage microtransaction and loot box mechanics, while still being able to produce some of the best looking games, then it just seems to me that these other publishers that are saying, oh no, we have to do this because otherwise the game is not profitable enough, they're just mismanaging their teams. Their teams are not doing a good job. You need proper budgeting, which is something that I've also brought up in the past. You need your teams to budget accordingly to what they can produce. Do not produce something that is so expensive to the point where you have to sacrifice gameplay in order to actually make a buck, because that is where things get really bad really fast. As a matter of fact, we've had a really good example of a game that is going after a specific audience. It is providing a really cool single player story. And this, I'm saying from what I've seen from videos and stuff, because even though I have played the game, I enjoyed what I've played of it. I haven't finished it yet. And that game is Hellblade: Senua's Sacrifice. And that game wasn't even a full price AAA. Doesn't have any microtransaction nonsense. Doesn't have any loot box nonsense. Anything. It is just straight up a single player game that you can play once, be done with it, enjoy it. And it looks great. It looks fantastic. Really good visuals, really good animation, really good art. It's a visually impressive game. And it's not even a $60 title. Doesn't have any of this microtransaction nonsense. It's just straight up a game like we used to have back in the day, you know? And now the way that the industry is going is actually something that I'm very curious to see what is going to happen, because the Nintendo Switch has entered the arena this year. And a lot of people were skeptical about the Nintendo Switch. What was it going to be able to do? Was it going to be a failure like the Wii U? What was going to happen with the Nintendo Switch? And I think the Nintendo Switch is something that is really going to improve on this whole situation, because ultimately, this is a console which is the weakest in terms of hardware of current generation consoles. And yet, it already has two games under its belt which are candidates for Game of the Year. Okay? And these are not games that are pushing the boundary of visual fidelity. However, they have beautiful art styles, fantastic animation, and most importantly of all, they have some of the best gameplay that we've experienced this year. Naturally, I'm talking about Zelda Breath of the Wild and Super Mario Odyssey. And it's like, again, this is on the weakest current generation hardware. Okay? And now we have all of these other developers that are like, oh man, we should put some games on the Switch. It's sold like over 7 million units so far. It's actually being pretty successful. And everybody wants to get on that. However, this is why things are going to get interesting now, because on the Switch, you don't have the argument that's like, oh, games are expensive because they need to look real good. Because games are not going to be able to push the boundaries of visual fidelity on the Switch. So your game can't just look good, it has to actually be good. And isn't that going to be something that we're all going to want to see? I know I do. So what do you guys think about all this? Leave me all your comments and feedback in the comment section below. Thank you all very much for watching this video. If you enjoyed it, make sure to hit that like button. It helps out a lot. If you are new here, subscribe so that you're always notified when there's a new video on the channel or a new live stream coming up. Remember to hit the bell icon, because now you have to do that, otherwise you don't get notified, which is kind of dumb. If you really, really enjoyed this video and would like to support the channel, consider sponsoring. There is a link in the description where you can go to the YouTube gaming version of this website and sponsor there. And it works very much like a Twitch subscription. Thank you all very much for watching, and I'll see you guys in the next one.